I would like to know if anyone of you or how many of you are already using SPSS, and please message in the inbox. Please let me know if how many of you are already well versed in SPSS, or you know something at least to work on. So please message. Yes, I can see one person has replied. So I hope at least some of you would be using the software. So this SPSS is basically a very popular software, and we perform various data analysis in biomedical sciences and also in other fields using SPSS. And the reason why SPSS is very popular is mainly because of its user interface. So I would say user interface means there are drop-down menus where you just have to click and you will get the analysis done. So this session is basically for beginners, and it's designed in such a way that we will take you from the basics of how the data, how the SPSS will look like, what is variable, how it can be entered, and such sort of things. So I'll just move on to the next slide. So before performing any analysis, we have to assure your data has a certain level of quality. That means from the research, whatever you're doing, the data that you collect, you have to assure that it meets a quality criteria. So it can be achieved in three ways. One is quality assurance, then second is quality control, and the third one is using data management. So now, what is quality assurance? Quality assurance, it relates to activities to ensure the quality of data before a data collection. So that means while you're designing your proforma or questionnaire itself, you have to check whether you have collected all the entities listed out properly in an adequate manner, how you'd be measuring it, what are the methods in which will it be sufficient to achieve your objectives, and so on. The second is aspect of data quality control, the second aspect is quality control. Quality control means you have to monitor when you're collecting the data, you have to maintain the quality, you have to ensure that it is properly collected. And the third one is data management. That means handling and processing of data throughout the study. So data management is also defined as an administrative process that includes acquiring, validating, storing, protecting, and processing the required data to ensure the accessibility, reliability, and timelessness of the data for its users. Now coming to SPSS software. So as I told you, this is very popular in biomedical field, and that is the reason that we thought of giving you an idea about how to work on SPSS, because many people use SPSS as it's very easy to use. So there are several data software which is available, and SPSS is one of the softwares. There are other softwares like SAS, R, Stata, EpiInfo, etc. If you take SAS, R, Stata, etc., it's not menu driven. SAS and R, for example, it's based on coding. You have to learn coding. You have to learn programming language to use it. You should know basic programming language to use SAS and R. You can still learn. I'm not telling it is not possible to learn. Everyone can learn it, but it requires a specific training in coding to use such softwares. Whereas SPSS is like you just click and you get the results quickly. So SPSS is a window-based program, and it is designed to perform data entry and analysis. It also gives you tables, graphs, etc. So SPSS software, as I told you, it's simple to learn and easy to execute the analysis by using SPSS. So if you look at when it was released, the first version was released somewhere in 1968. It was called as SPSS-INC. And later it was acquired by IBM company. And then the later on versions were named as IBM SPSS software. So SPSS stands for Statistical Package for Social Sciences. And later it was changed to Statistical Product and Service Solution. That is what it stands for, SPSS. So the current version available is SPSS 26, if I'm not wrong. And it can be downloaded if you are interested in learning. I think the trial version is available to download, and you can download it from the link that is given here in the PPT. Or if you just go to Google and type SPSS trial version download, you will be able to go to this same link and download the software for learning. But this is actually a trial version, so you can't use it for more than 14 days, I guess. So after that, you cannot continue using it. You'll have to purchase it. So if your institution is interested in it's not so cheap. It comes with a good cost. So it can be like your institution can purchase it, and it's like a perpetual license. That means if you buy it for the institute, it can be used forever. So, and the cost is like somewhere ranging from, if I'm not wrong, it's like $2,800 or something. It's an initial base price. So, and it depends on what you're choosing, what version you're using, the price will change. Now, how to, so I can just show you that link. I'll just take you to that link. I'll show you where it can be downloaded. So if you open this link, you can see this is the window that comes. So here you can just click on try SPSS software for free, where you can download the trial version. But only thing is that they're asking for some details related to email ID or such things, additional details, and you have to verify the email ID before downloading. So this is the link. So as I indicated earlier, the quality of data is very important before you start the analysis. I think in the previous sessions, I think Anita would have told you about the data collection of data, how the data is collected, what are the different methods in which the data can be collected, and so on. So here, before starting the analysis itself, you have to check for the certain things that you have to keep in mind. The first one is data cleaning. That includes collating of data, checking data for accuracy. The next one is data coding. Third is variable naming. Fourth one is developing and documentation of database structure. Fifth one is entering data into SPSS or MS Excel. And then preparing the statistical analysis plan and performing the analysis. So what is meant by data cleaning? So as you know, in any research study, there will be different types of data, starting from social demographic, clinical data, laboratory investigations, biochemical, biological, radiological parameters, etc. Then the data will be, there might be a follow-up data also. There will be observational data. So all these are there. So what you have to do is you have to check the accuracy of the data. So you have to see whether the data is accurate. Okay, so how do we check for that accuracy? So the first thing that you have to do is, you have to check whether, suppose if you are using a questionnaire for collecting the data, sometimes you might be writing the responses like age of the patient, height, weight, etc. You'll be writing by hand. So you have to see whether the responses are legible, whether it's not clearly written means you won't get the correct data, right? So you have to check that. then are all the questions answered? That means you have to see whether all the responses, all the questions are what you're asking the patient, whether it is there, whether it's been recorded properly, etc. Then you have to see whether not only that, even if it is recorded, sometimes it might be incomplete. Okay. For example, if you ask, are you a smoker? Then the corresponding questions like duration of smoking, frequency of smoking, those details also you have to take. So that will help you in doing a better analysis. So you have to check whether all the responses are complete and it is given and the corresponding questions are also answered by the respondent. So if suppose you don't get at one attempt, if the patient is not responding, you can try again. You can try to get information later on. So that way you can try to see that the data, the response is complete related to your study. Then you have to see that the information that you collect, for example, if you have the unit of measurements, so it has to be clearly mentioned as whether it's in centimeters or inches or kilograms. So for one patient, you cannot enter centimeters. Second patient, you cannot enter meters, like that. So there should not be any discrepancy. Then the next part is consistency check. So a consistency check example is, suppose you ask patient, are you employed or not? So he says, it's not employed. But you see that by mistake, you have entered some income. Okay, it happens. So such consistency checks has to be done so that you ensure that you are writing it correctly or you are entering the details correctly. Then, for example, another example for consistency check is how you can do is for example, how it can go wrong is non-diabetic patient receiving oral hypoglycemic drug. So the first question is, are you diabetic? Yes or no? So you just write no, and then duration of hypoglycemic drug you have given as 10 years. So that means there's some error in that. So maybe you have ticked it wrong. Instead of ticking yes, instead of marking yes, you have marked it as no. So such discrepancies might happen. Then especially for age. For age also, you have to, it's better always to do a consistency check by asking the date of birth to ensure that the age entered is correct. You can have date of birth as well as age so that you can actually check if the age is being written wrongly. You can just go back and check using date of birth. And there's also an important thing here, which I would like to mention. It's always better to have a common unique identification number. So when you have collected the data, you usually give a serial number or something like that, starting from, suppose there are 100 patients, you start from 1, 2, 3, 4, etc., and up to 100. So instead of that, if you can have one more unique identification number, for example, hospital ID or Aadhaar number or something like that, that will also help when you want to trace later on, when you want to do a follow-up or when you need some additional information, all those things will help. Now coming to coding of data. So this is also an important aspect. So in the next class also, we'll be looking into more practical examples on how data can be coded before doing the analysis. So before the data is entered into the computer, in the questionnaire itself, you can make numerical codes. For example, in this data, you can see the response like blood group. It is A, B, C, and AB. So here you can give, instead of blood group O, it is 1, A, it is 2, 3, and 4. So it's being numerically coded. Why we have numerically coded is, so the software won't identify if it's a string variable, certain comparisons or analysis may not be possible. Because by default, the software reads, when it does the analysis, it will require the data to be in numerical format. So that's the reason why we usually prefer recoding the data according in numerical format, so that it'll be easy for the software to understand and read it and analyze it quickly. Otherwise, once you enter OA like that, again, it has to be recoded as 1, 2, 3, 4 before you do the analysis. So it's always better to have this code list first itself and do it during the data entry so that it will be easy for analysis. And suppose if you have an information which like don't know or there is something missing, then you can give a code which is not in the code list. For example, here there is one person who doesn't know that his blood group. So he has not responded for that. So that means you can give a code of 99, which is not in the list, so that for the analysis, we can analyze the missing value separately. Instead of leaving it blank, it's always better to give a code. Suppose if you're taking into this data into SPSS, you can mention, you can tell the software that this is a missing value or the missing code, and the software will consider it as missing and it will do the analysis for you, excluding those missing. So that is why this kind of code is given. Then another example, gender, male, female. So male can be coded as one and female can be coded as two. So after you do the data entry, you have to check for errors. Like once you enter the data also, you have to check for errors. Like you can say, for example, if you have entered all the missing values correctly, or whether you have missed out something, you have not entered properly. So all those, if you have entered 9 instead of 99, or if you entered some kind of accuracy checks for errors can be done. So now naming variables name, how do you put in SPSS? That I'll show you when we, I'll just show you in SPSS software itself. So like you can't just, like how we put it Excel, the variable names cannot be very lengthy, or there is a certain rule for naming variables when it comes to SPSS. So in variable name, you can't use a space when we put it in SPSS. It won't recognize, it won't take if there is a space. In the, suppose, for example, you want to put age in years. So if you give space between age in and years, it won't read. So you can either use an underscore in between, or you can use a camel's case. Camel case means you just capitalize the first word of each, can capitalize age, A as capital, in, I as capital. So this way it will take. The second rule is you cannot use special characteristics when you are putting the variable name. The first letter, you cannot use these special characteristics. Third is it cannot begin with a number. So variable name cannot be starting with a number. Then each variable must be unique. There shouldn't be any repetition of the same name. You can give as age one or age two, like that you can give, but age like that same name you cannot give. Then it usually takes up to 64 characters or less. So now going to, I'll just show you the SPSS menu, how it will look like. So this is the, so this is the SPSS window. So once you open the SPSS software, you can see different tabs. So the first one is title bar, where it will display the name of the data set. The second one is the menu bar, where you can see the different options that are available. For example, file, edit, view, data, transform, analyze, etc. Then there are a set of, like in Excel spreadsheet, there are a set of rows and columns. If you're down, you can see there are two options, data view and variable view. So this is the basic like format of how the data would look like when you open the SPSS window. So I'll just show you how the data also will look like. So this is one example of one of our data. So this is this is how the data will look like. It'll look like how we enter in Excel itself. So I just go to the window, spaces window. So I hope you can see the program. Hello. Yeah, I hope you can see the program. Okay, so this is how it looks like. Are you able to see my screen? Okay, so when you open the SPSS program, this is a menu bar, and there are different options, file, edit, view, etc. This is the title bar, which I told you, and there are different, if you see here in data view, you can see the two, I'll just highlight it one minute. So if you see the cursor, this is the variable view and this is the data view. So in variable view, there are different names, like name, type. In variable view, you can see name, type, width, decimals, so on. So before going to what is in variable view, I'll just show you how the data, if you enter any value, how it will show it in how the data will come in SPSS. So I'm just going to enter some numbers here. So I have added numbers 1 to 10, that is in variable 1. And here I'm just going to type some numbers again. So this is variable 2. So here, okay. So when you are entering data, if you just enter the value, just before without mentioning the variable name, what it is, you're just entering, it will give you like VAR0001, like that. It will just give you a sequence of numbers. So if I want to name the variable, for example, the first column, I want to name it as serial number. So in this window, this rows correspond to each case or each patient information, and column corresponds to each variable. So here in the row, I am just this is the first patient details. That data what we are going to enter will happen to come in a horizontal way. Okay. And the columns, it is vertical. The variables will be in vertical order. For example, this is a serial number. So I want to put it as serial number instead of it. By default, it will come as VAR 1 or something like that. If I want to rename it, I just have to go to variable view And here I put serial number, SLNO, serial number. So that becomes the first variable name. So you can see here it has come in the data view. Now variable view, again I'm going second variable, I want to name it as age. So in variable view, I can click here. Age. See, a different variable type has been mentioned, whether it is a comma, dot, date. Suppose I want to mention the date of birth, I have to change it to date format. So if I click on date, there are different ways of how date can be represented. Like for example, usually we follow DDMMYY format. So you can click on DDMMYY and click OK. So it will consider that variable as date variable. So if you enter the date, it will automatically read it as a date variable. So usually it will be numeric most of the time. String means if you have any character variable. Use it as a string variable. And maybe for analysis, if it is required, you can retain like that. So you can click on string and change it to string if it is a character. Now coming to the width. Width means the width of the column. Suppose I make it 250 or something. You can see in the 150 it is taken. 40. So if I change the width to 40 in data view, actually it is just for increasing the spacing of the variable. Here I can't see much change, but it's like changing the width of the column that this option is being used. Then coming to decimals, you can mention how many decimal points you have in the data, especially when it comes to quantitative data. You have to give the decimal values like BMI or height or age or something. You can have a decimal point also. So that is mentioned, that can be mentioned here, number of decimal points. Then if you have, as I told you, this label option is used. Suppose I can't name, give the complete name. For example, variable name cannot be too much lengthy. So I can, instead of giving the complete variable name here, I can give it as a label like age in years. So here you can have a space also, or you can use special characters also. No problem. So in this situation, where you want to read the complete name for your understanding, you can give it as a label instead of giving it in the variable name. Then there is values. Value means suppose there is a code. I'll just enter. It's like name. So here, this is actually gender. I've created one more variable, gender. So here gender, one means male and two means female. That is the code that we have made. So in gender, if you want to, because in the data it is one and two, and it will be, you won't be able to, when you do the analysis also, in the analysis output, it will show as one and two itself. So once you get the results, you won't know what is one and what is two. For that reason, if you have a code, you can give a label for that so that you will understand what is one and what is two. In the results also, it will be displayed. So suppose like one, value one, label is male. Value two, female. So when you do the analysis, instead of one and two, in the results also it will be displayed as male, female. So whatever you have labeled, it will display as the same. The values which you mentioned here in the code, instead of coming as one and two, you will get male and female. So that's the idea of having this option value. Then suppose there is a missing value. For example, I just go to the data. Suppose this patient data was missing. So I have not coded it right now. So if it's not been coded, it will show it as a blank. There won't be any value. So instead of, as I told you, it's always better to give a code for missing so that you can exclude it from the analysis when you do the analysis, and you can give any extreme value or any value which cannot be in that range. For example, a patient cannot have an age of 999, right? So that can be used as a code for missing values. So I'm using code as 999 for missing. So here in the variable view also, you have to mention the code as discrete missing value. Here in click on the missing, discrete missing value 999. So this indicates that patients, wherever in the data there is 999, then the software understands that it is a missing value and it has to be included when we do the analysis. Then this is just the alignment where you can see here left, center, right. So this is just to show which side the data will be. If I make it as left, it will come to left side. If it is right, it will come to right side. The values will come towards the right side and so on. That is just the alignment. Then there is something called measure. So measure means you have to, I hope you know about the levels of measurements. And I just take you to the slide also once again. So here in measure, there are three options. One is scale, nominal, and ordinal. So in the previous class, I think you would have come across this, what is meant by nominal data, what is ordinal, and what is scale. So scale means it can be either interval scale or in ratio. So in SPSS, there are only three options. So the scale variable can be ratio data, or it can be interval data. Okay. So the interval data is actually, it is measured. So if you see the ratio data means the difference between the measurement, there is a true zero value. For example, if you take height or weight or like quantitative data like height or weight, there is a true zero value. So that's why it's called as a ratio data. And interval data means there is no true zero value. And then the difference between, so for example, if you take the IQ scores or something, the difference are equal. So that's why it is called interval data. So in interval data, another example is temperature. So such data, the ratio and interval data together is called as scale in SPSS. And ordinal data means there is an order, rank, category. Like for example, we can say that socioeconomic classification is an ordinal data. Severity of pain, it is ordinal data. Whereas nominal data, there is no order or intrinsic ranking. Like for example, gender, male, female, it's a nominal data. Presence of illness, yes and no, it's a nominal data. So that those are the different scales of measurement. So let's go back to the SPSS window. So here you can see scale. So the first variable, for example, serial number, it doesn't matter actually, because we can just put it as ordinal, because anyways we won't be analyzing the serial number. So it's an order 1, 2, 3, etc. So we can put it as ordinal. Age. So age is again here, age is not grouped. It is like just the exact age that has been entered in this data. So here we can give it as scale itself, because it is a quantitative data, and so we are just mentioning it as scale. Then next is gender. So gender is again a nominal data, because it's like male, female, there's no order or intrinsic ranking. So it is a nominal data. So you have to define the measures before you do the analysis. So this is very important, because depending upon the measure, you have to choose which analysis you have to apply. Now, because you can't, for example, if you want to calculate mean, you can calculate mean for age, because it is in ratio or interval scale, it's quantitative. So you can calculate mean. But if it is qualitative data, you cannot calculate mean. It doesn't make sense. If you want to calculate mean of gender or average, it doesn't make sense. You have to calculate percentage. So for nominal or ordinal scale, we usually calculate percentages. For ratio or interval scale, we usually use measures of descriptive statistics and all that we use to analyze the data. So the next is the role. So the role variable is actually, this comes into picture when we do advanced analysis, like for example, regression, or, you know, coming in the coming classes, you'll come to know what is exactly role variable. Like if you want to define an independent variable and a dependent variable, in that case, you can use this option as role. And you can select what exactly is the role for that variable. So we'll discuss it about it in the coming classes when we do those topics in detail. So this is about the basic data entry, how we can perform using SPSS. And I'll just show you where the analyze option is. So suppose you want to analyze the data, you have to click on the analyze in the menu bar, and here you can see the different statistical analysis that can be performed using SPSS. So the version that I'm using is SPSS 20. In the recent versions, there are more options, advanced analytics option, which is available. But for a basic user, I would say any version not less than 17 can be used for the purpose of, even if you're using an older version also, you can follow the method of analysis is the same. So I hope you understood about the SPSS. You got an idea about how the data has to be entered, how it has to be defined when it comes to the SPSS software. If you have any questions, you can ask me right now. Regarding. Okay, so I am not getting any questions right now. So I'll just continue. Then by the end of my presentation, we can have some 5 minutes or so for discussion. Okay. So hi, I hope you can see the PPT. So as I told you, once you check for data accuracy and data errors, you have to go for statistical analysis. So if you if the data is proper, it won't take much time for performing any analysis. If your data is collected properly, it's been entered and verified at all the stages, then it will be easy to do perform any statistical analysis. So basically, when we talk about statistical analysis plan, we have to think about descriptive method and inferential method. So descriptive, which includes tabulation, graphical representation, using different types of graphs, also the descriptive statistics, which was discussed yesterday. And then comes to inferential statistics and the different methods which can be performed for the specific data. Then if possible, we can also do some multivariate analysis if you are looking for any predictors or any prognosis, if you have any factors which you want to predict relating to your outcome, that also can be done. So that is how the statistical analysis plan would be made once you come up with your complete data. So it's not mandatory that the data has to be entered in SPSS. There is an option where you can enter the data in Microsoft or Excel, and then it can be transported from Microsoft Excel to SPSS. So that's an easier method which you can adopt. But this is also possible. If you all want to enter in SPSS directly, you can enter in SPSS directly also. So I will just show you before I stop my presentation. I have a small exercise for you. So are you able to view the Excel sheet here?
Yes.
I hope all of you can see. So there are some variables here. Okay. So the first, as I told you, this is an Excel sheet, not an SPSS. So I just want you to identify some mistakes in this file before I wind up for today's session. Because these are very minute things when it comes to data entry, but we have to be very careful. So I thought I'll just show you, and if you are able to pick some errors, please message in the inbox. So I can, I hope it is visible. Till this you can see. FBS, you can see till this, if you see this part. So if there are any errors which you can find out, please message in the inbox. Yes, I have one message here. Missing data in the income column. Data is missing in some boxes. Yes, that's right. And it has not been coded. That is correct. Missing data in the income column. That is correct. Age, anything? You can find any mistakes in age? Are you able to notice any mistake in age? Yes, exactly. Age noted in both male and female. Okay. I'm sorry. Uh, One thing, if you remember what I told you, age here is one is, this is not 40, this is FO, sorry, F4O. It is not zero, it is O. That is one error. Okay. So those who have not, because it's an online platform, it is little slightly difficult to make out. That's why. So this is actually, this is 4O instead of zero. By mistake, it is being put as. So this is how when we enter manually, these are the problems that happens. Yes, Kirtana has messaged. One age is in the left side. This is in the left side because there is a character. If it is numeric, it will be in the right aligned thing. Okay, so yeah, that is good. You have identified it. When it comes to systolic, I'll just scroll it down. You can see here systolic and diastolic BP is being entered as together. How many of you think it is correct? Do you think we can analyze if you have a data where two things are entered together? Will it be easy to analyze? No, right? So whenever you are entering BP related values, you have to enter in separate. Yes, we have to enter it in separate columns. For example, SBP has to be entered in separate column and DBP has to be entered in separate column. Okay, so now in FBS there is nothing. Yes. So I don't know if you can see if here I have highlighted a value here. So this is for cholesterol entered 112, so which is not possible. So these are some kind of mistakes that usually comes and it goes unnoticed. And if we take the average, your average serum value will shoot up. Cholesterol values will be very high on an average. So because of this one extreme value. Okay, so these are the things you have to be very careful, because usually when it comes to research data or thesis data, you have a lot of variables like this, not just BP or cholesterol, or you have a lot of quantitative variables, and this is a common mistake that happens. Okay, same way for triglyceride also, there is some extreme value here. Then if you see, I think those are the common things which I wanted to tell you. Here one BMI is more 70 is there. So these are some of the common errors that happens when we enter the data. Okay. And more on this, that is more discussion on this will be done in the next class on how the data has to be entered for the appropriate for the analysis, and how it can be taken to SPSS. If the data is entered in SPSS, how the data can be exported to SPSS, that we can we'll discuss in the next class. Now. So when you're so the more on this will be discussed in the next class, but before stopping, I would like to tell that when you're entering data in Excel sheet, you have to be careful about these things. Proper code has to be given. The second is, one more thing is, you have to avoid the string responses as much as possible. For example, if there's a mode of delivery, parity, etc., try to code it. Try to code it numerically. That would be better. Then avoid blank space in between. That means you should not leave a blank column in between the two variables when you're entering. Then clinical diagnosis, you can, instead of yes and no, you can put it as 1 and 2 or 0 and 1, present absent, like that you can give. So that will be easy for you to enter also, as well as it will be easy for you to analyze. Then coming to missing data, as I told you, you have to enter the, if there is any missing values, you can give a code for it. That will help you in easy, making it easy for analysis. Then if there is separate columns, properly enter BP in separate columns. Then you use the same unit of measurement, and it has to be uniform. For example, a duration of illness or duration of any particular condition. You cannot have one person's duration in month, another person's duration in year, like that. So for all patients, if you are entering in months, it has to be in months. If it is in years, it has to be in years. So I hope today's topic, you are clear with today's topic. So what we discussed today in brief was about SPSS and what is the importance of data quality when it comes to analysis. Then we discussed about the different levels of measurements and how it is given in SPSS, how the variables can be created and entered in SPSS. And then we discussed about fundamentals of data entry and what are the errors that can happen when you enter the data in SPSS. So with that, I will wind up today's session. Thank you for the patient listening. And I'll be happy to take your questions if there are any. Is it, I have one question, I think, in the chat box. Is it correct to enter male and female, or should we enter as 1 and 2? It is not wrong if you enter as M and F for male and female. If you are, suppose you are doing a cross-tabulation, or if you are like, if you want to compare like comorbidity with male and female, then you can enter it as male and female. But when you have to do some other data manipulation, suppose I want to select only males and then do the analysis, or only females and then do the analysis, not for males. In that situation, it will be difficult if you put M and F. So it's always better to give the code as 1 and 2. Okay, so it's not wrong if you put M and F, but for ease of analysis, it will be better to put it as 1 and 2. Do we have any other questions? Sir, I didn't hear your question, sir.
If your data is missing in the Excel sheet,
yes, sir.
Should we leave it blank or give some other code in the Excel sheet itself?
You can give the code in the Excel sheet itself, sir. And then you can take it to SPSS. You can give it as a wild code, which is not there in the list. And then you can, because it will be easy for you to identify, like as I gave for age, I gave 999, which just does not exist. So that will tell us it is a missing value. So it can be entered in Excel, and then you can take it to SPSS for analysis. So tomorrow, Anita will tell you how the data can be taken directly from Excel to SPSS. Yes, sir. We will wind up today's session.
We join at 8 p.m. tomorrow.
Yes, sir. Okay. Thank you. So thank you, everyone.